We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. I am your host, Dave Bourne, and it is July 13th, 2016. And I am coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday, usually at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. Tonight, we started a little early the last two nights so I could get in some extra time. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud. And the next day on Stitcher and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we, of course, are always happy to hear from you. You can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for all one word. And you can get all that information and more at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which also has the links to all our social media, as well as the archives that are posted every weekend. And original articles, blogs. I'm currently working on I don't know how many part series it's going to be. So far, it's a four-part series on the legalization of drugs and why we should go back to how drugs were in 1914. And that's basically when they passed the first drug law related to opium. And you can also get contact information and more. So today we are continuing our talk from yesterday regarding the Dallas shooting, the police, and everything related to that. So a whole bunch of different things that we're going to cover that are all related to the police and to the shooting in Dallas, as well as people getting killed by police and all of that in between. Now, just to kind of summarize what I talked about yesterday, we really didn't get that far. I talked about Black Lives Matter, and there's some stuff I have to add today after some things I heard on the news. And I talked about the exploitation, of course, that will happen by politicians and the police, that they're going to use this. They're already saying that police are scared, or of course, they don't use the word scared, but that it's affecting police. And if you ever looked at, and this is even years ago when the two officers were shot and killed here in Las Vegas, the things that the police say, and it's just, it's crazy, man, the egos that these fucking people have and the what they say. You would think that, especially if you're not in that department, I understand if it happened to your department specifically, but, and this is even months after, or even before the things that the police would say. And there's a website that they have to verify if you're a cop. I think Cops One or something like that. And the ego that these guys have is just, it is ridiculous. It really is insane, because you would think that the way it should be is that they should be humble civil servants, and we all know that they are not. But one more thing regarding Black Lives Matter, and I'll get away from that. And really, I don't have an issue with people protesting anything related to race if they feel that the race that they're a part of is being singled out and oppressed for something. And I think they have some valid complaints, especially with the court system, really. And I've seen that up close. But I think a lot of that stuff is beginning to change, but it's still pretty bad. I think it's gotten better, but the most oppressive form of racism is via the government that I've seen. Now, I might be thinking more about when I was in high school and I saw racism, like witnessed a lot of it. And of course, it wasn't the racism of the 60s. I'm not that old. But it was the, you know, name calling, and it really wasn't to anybody's face. It was just the behind the back, because they were scared to go up to people's faces. But there was some hate there. And that's what I consider racism, hate. You know, you have, I've talked about this, discrimination is when you actually act on your feelings. And you might not hate somebody to discriminate against them. You might just base that off of prejudice, where you think that, well, because somebody's a certain race, they can't do this job. It doesn't mean you hate them. It just, it's a prejudice that you're acting on. And then, of course, there's prejudice, same thing, where it's the feelings you have and then the discrimination is acting on them. But same thing, you can be prejudiced and not hate. And I mean that in a sense of, you know, you prejudge people. So if you see a kid who is dressed up like hip hop style or something like that, you automatically say, think, well, they must be part of a gang or something. And I'm just using that as an example. That's prejudice. You're prejudging them. But that doesn't mean you hate them. That's just a prejudgment there. What I think is the most dangerous thing, obviously, is hate. And that's what racism is. And they want to throw around racism, they being media especially, want to throw around the word racism like just anybody does anything or talks about anything that's related to race and they're racist. And it's crazy, because that's not what racism is, in my opinion. In my opinion, racism, or even beyond race, whether it's religion or, and I've been, I guess, I wouldn't say discriminated against based on my father being Jewish, but called names a couple times when I was younger. And, you know, I hear people still discriminate against Jews. I mean, I don't care. I don't really associate with a race per se. I mean, I'm a person and that's how I view it. But the organization Black Lives Matter, this is what they're doing that's really bothering me, that's pissing me off, is that they're taking away from people talking about the real issue of the police being out of control and doing something about it and taking away their power and going after the police for what they're doing and things like that, taking away their armored vehicles and all of these things. They're just talking about it, and they just did it on, you know, Fox News. They're talking about the other side where, oh, the police aren't racist. But that's all they're talking about. This has turned into the police versus black people. And that's not what it is. It's the police versus all people. Because the police are the fucking dogs of the politicians that are going to be the ones that they're building up. Why do you think they're arming them with automatic weapons and tanks to, if the government, or as the, I wouldn't even say if, as the government passes all these laws and takes more control, they're going to be the ones to enforce that. And they are. And they're coming down on everybody. And what that does is it totally deflects the conversation into race. And I don't want to see any black people killed by police any more than I want to see anybody killed by police. But I want to focus on getting them to stop by getting rid. I want to get rid of police altogether. And talking about race is not going to do anything except maybe get the police department's racial training or some bullshit like that, or more interaction or more understanding. That's what it's going to do. And that's not going to do shit. It's still going to, there's an attack on our freedom. There is an attack on our rights by, you know, the police are the enforcers there. I mean, it's the government, but they're part of the government. So that's why I said, don't forget about the DAs, the judges, the politicians, the, you know, whoever you think really controls the federal government, because all those people are just as responsible. So don't fucking forget about them, too. The police are getting the brunt of all of it, but they should get what they're getting. But at the same time, don't forget about the people behind them, because the people behind them are just as bad because they're pulling the strings. Now, the police are bad because they're letting their strings be pulled. So that's what I have against Black Lives Matter. I don't have an issue with them talking about race being a part of this, which it is to an extent. And I think, as I had mentioned, it's more prejudice that the police are scared and they think every black person's a criminal. I don't think that all police hate. I think that there is racism in police departments, but I don't know that it's the majority just hate black people or something like that. But they look at them as criminals. And I think they do have a history of being racist. I think that's changing, even though we're seeing all of these murders and things like that. They happened before. We just didn't see them because we didn't have the internet. We didn't have the resources we have now. So that's my issue with them. And so now I'm forced to go and look up all the fucking white people, unarmed white people that got killed. And I don't want to make this about race because it's not about race to me. It's about blue versus people. It's about government versus non-government versus just regular people. I hate the word citizen because it's meaningless. So I don't want to say the word citizen. So I just say people. But, you know, there was a 19-year-old killed on June 25th. His mother actually witnessed it. He was unarmed, murdered by the Fresno police. And there's video of it. They won't release it. No one talked about that. There was a 29-year-old killed in prison in Mississippi, and his death was ruled a homicide, but they made it look like a suicide. And obviously, the police were involved. There was a older guy who Henry David Howell. This is about in the last month. Police went to the wrong house. It's nighttime. He sees a shadow outside. So, of course, he goes out with his gun. Police just, you know, blast him and kill him. And there's two other ones where one, they claim he had knives. However, there's a bunch that say, oh, well, they had a knife. They had this. They, you know, oh, they lunged at me. And police lie. They're full of shit. So you don't know whether to believe that or not. You know, there were some that said they had guns, but there were five that the most disturbing, or the two most disturbing, and this is all in the past month, is Dylan Noble, the 19-year-old, and then the older guy who did have a gun, but he legally had a gun at his own house. So my point being, and then there's just as much when it comes to Hispanic people as well. It's just they're not talking about it in government media because the whole purpose is to make this about race. Because the two things you're able to do is, one, deflect away from doing something about the police and the police being a problem for everybody. They're making it, oh, the police is just a problem when it comes to black people, and that's it. And that's what the media has accepted on both sides, whether you believe, whether it's a channel that leans toward, you know, progressive or conservative, they just say the opposite. But that's what they talk about, race. It's all about race. And it's fucked up. And I mean, I shouldn't just blame Black Lives Matter, because I think the majority of people, and I said this yesterday, actually know what's really going on anyway. And Black Lives Matter has been hijacked by, you know, political operatives. And I should blame the media, government media, and blame the government, obviously, because they're controlling the media as well. So that really bothers me, because it's totally throwing things. It's doing exactly what the government wants to do, and we're getting fucked because of it. And then the shooting, and the media is presenting it. You know, Dr. Boyce Watkins, who I don't want to label him a racist because I haven't heard enough, but he's on the border there. He's black. But about being racist against white people, I don't know if I need to hear more of him to say that, because I don't want to throw that word around. But he had a good point when he said, you know, cops get special treatment. But he same thing, but compared to black people. And it's no, cops get special treatment, like they're showing all their funerals and all this stuff, and the people that are killed by cops don't. And that's what people aren't understanding. All these white people that got killed by police and have been getting killed by police, no one gives a fuck about them neither, because it's all about the police. The police have the power. The police are the ones that are put higher than anybody. Maybe if you're part of the 1% or you're somebody really important, outside of that, it doesn't matter. And that's what a lot of people are doing, and they're dividing people. Because what it should be is everybody that sees what the police are doing getting together and fighting against the police. And I don't mean literally fighting like hand-to-hand combat, but and these rallies, you know, it's good to have protests and stuff like that. It's not going to go anywhere, because the system is not going to change. It's going to go where they want it to go, and they being the government, where they want to federalize the police, and they want to have, you know, probably like training on race and stuff like that. But it's not going to go to stop any of the things that are happening and the police violating our rights. And they already want to give the police more power. So in North Carolina, they don't want to release. There's a bill where they want to make footage, I don't know if this passed, off limits to public. to the public. So any footage that they have from dash cams or any other cams, they want to make off limits to the public. And what they're going to do, too, is say, well, look what happens. If when people see what police do, they end up doing crazy things like the guy who shot the police and they get angry at police. And that's crazy to say something like that because obviously, yeah. So you want to hide what they do so people don't get mad at them? And then there's a bill already that wants to make killing a police officer a federal crime. And don't fucking tell me that that bill wasn't sitting there for a while. Because all of a sudden, oh, it's there. Just waiting for something to happen. And that's what they do. They write up these fucking bills and then they exploit shit. And that's what they're doing in this. Why not make it a federal crime when a police officer kills a fucking civilian? You don't see any bills, anybody submitting any bills like that. No. And part of that is because everything is being focused around race. Go to killed by police. You'll see how many fucking, they even put race there now. Just because of all of this shit about race. And granted, racism exists. Anybody who's being honest knows it exists. It exists in the police department. It exists in the government. Why you would want to federalize the police and give the government, federal government, more power is insane to me. Why people that aren't anti-police are progressives and want more government is insane to me, because the government is the most racist and oppressive organization throughout history and currently now. It was the fucking federal government, or state as well, but I think it was even a federal law that they defended it to return runaway slaves. Slavery itself, it was a law. It wasn't people. It wasn't people just saying, oh, we want slavery. I mean, I'm not saying they didn't want it in the South, but it's the government. So that's why I don't get people that it's like you had at a Occupy Wall Street or some kind of other rally where it was a totally ridiculous progressive rally. And then people are yelling, fuck the police. And it's like it doesn't go together, man. If you pass more laws, guess what that does? It gives police more power. It sounds like a group like Black Lives Matter, again, which has been, in my opinion, infiltrated by political operatives, is, you know, contradicts itself anyway, but wants more government and really just wants, like, okay, if you just kill less black people and more white people and even it out, we're good with that. And I would say that about the, like, stop and frisk. I was totally against stop and frisk. Because stop and frisk is, to me, violates people's rights. I don't have to, it doesn't matter to me what race it's violating. It's violating all black people's rights. But it's violating people's rights, so I care about it. But it seemed like the people that were against it were just like, well, you don't have to get rid of it. Just search more white people. Which is ridiculous. And not because I give a fuck about, you know, like I have some kind of alliance towards white people any more than I do towards black people or any people. I mean, my people, I've said this before, are people that support freedom and liberty, true freedom and liberty. Those are my people. I don't give a fuck what you are. those are my people. And just because of somebody's fucking skin color or religion or whatever, you know, and I talked about this on a whole show when I talked about the history of rap and how I grew up with it. And I mean, I used to hang around with all black kids, and in high school, I sat at, there was one table at lunch that was all black people, and I was like the only non-black person that sat there, really. I had braids in my hair and shit. A couple people, I remember this lady thought I was like mixed or something. But if I got a tan though, I'm not, I guess it's hard for me to compare myself to like the average white person, 'cause I'm not. So when it comes to police and stuff like that, you know, I've been harassed by police. I've, you know, all of this shit that I could talk about, but I've seen and heard stories from other people as well. Your average white person, it's just, you know, if they sit there and kiss their ass, usually they'll, you know, they'll still give you an attitude. They'll still treat you like shit, but they'll be less inclined, you know, to pull a gun or whatever. But this whole idea, and I talked about yesterday, I played Rudy Giuliani's interview where he says, basically, just obey the police, whatever they say. And no, you need to stand up for your rights, because if you don't, they're going to keep violating your rights more and more. So you need to stand up for them. Now, most people think that if they stand up for their rights, they're not going to get killed. They know they may get arrested when they shouldn't. But nobody expects to get killed for standing up for their rights. And when I say standing up for their rights, I'm not talking about anything physical. I'm just talking about, you know, not answering questions and not just obeying whatever a police officer says. If they tell you to do something that is unconstitutional or illegal or violates your rights, you know, of course, he says, well, figure it out in court. Yeah, when you go to court, trust me, it's not going to be resolved. They're not going to do anything. They're going to take the officer's word, and that's it. There are some people who have won in lawsuits. If you look at the amount of interactions with police and the amount of people that actually got money from lawsuits, the majority of people that got money from lawsuits, first of all, was people that had family members murdered, first of all, or were beaten so fucking badly and it got on camera. And, you know, you have things here and there. For the most part, nothing's going to happen. And once you get arrested, you've already lost. Unless you somehow get money. So you have this happening to everybody. Whether it was always happening to everybody or not, I don't know. Does it happen more to black people? Yes, it does. But it happens to everybody. And this whole division is exactly what the government wants. And to make it about racism is exactly what the government wants. And we're giving them exactly what they want and not accomplishing fucking shit. That's why you have a guy who gets frustrated and feels like, hey, I got to do something. Now, as far as the choice of what he did, I think he made the wrong choice, and I don't condone what he did. However, at the same time, I honestly don't have any hate or ill will or anything towards Micah Johnson. because I can understand where he was coming from. Now, at the same time, do I feel bad for the cops and their families? It's hard not to. Even though, as I've said, they're part of a gang. And when you're part of a gang, things like that are going to happen. But it's hard just not to feel bad. Because, you know, the ones that got shot and don't have any permanent damage, I guess I don't feel bad for them at all. But the ones that actually died, it's, you know, it's more about human life, I think, than anything else. And that's, you know, you won't see me praying for them, or not that I pray anyway, or, you know, changing my opinion or anything like that. So I'm not going that far. But it's hard not to at times feel bad when I talk about it. You know? So I guess it depends on the mood I'm in when I'm talking about it. But it's just, it's unfortunate that he felt that this was his only option to do something. And it's unfortunate for him that at 25, his life is over. And they blew him up with a robot bomb, and we'll talk about that too. But I do feel bad, but at the same time, I realize that, look, you know, maybe those officers are good people. Maybe I don't believe there are any good cops because they've kidnapped people, obviously, but maybe they're some of the nicer cops. And I say that with the assumption that, you know, all cops are bad, but they're less bad, really. So maybe they weren't. Maybe they were bad guys. Of course, everyone's going to say, oh, they were the nicest person because that's what they do in death. Except when you're killed by a cop, then you're the worst person ever. They never do that to a cop. They don't release their fucking records. And I was saying this yesterday. And that's why the Dr. Bryce Johnson, who I want to listen to a little more before I really make a judgment about him, but he had said the same thing where he doesn't have anything against the shooter, or he doesn't feel bad for the cops. And on one side of it, you know, them being in Dallas, and I don't know how many people were killed by Dallas police, and the two recent, see, you can't even really talk about it like that because you could say the two recent murders. Well, along with those, there's a fucking list of, you know, 20, 30 people in the past week or something like that. Those were just the two that got caught on video that looked really bad. Because you don't even know what really happens. If it's cops and somebody else, they could say, oh, he came at us with a knife. It makes no fucking sense, though. Because you read these stories, and the majority of them is he pointed a gun. I don't think I've seen the amount that actually says that they had a shootout with the police. I did see a few, but are more the exception than the rule of people that are killed by police. That's where if the cops couldn't fire unless they were fired upon. And somebody said that, and I have this clip too. This guy's like, what do you want, police not to be able to shoot unless they're shot at? Yeah, they're fucking trained police. And there's ways to, you know, if when you're out there, it's your fucking priorities. And I talked about the Detroit Threat Management Center, and their priority was life. It's about your priorities, because you can try to back off. You can get in positions where you get yourself out of danger, but maybe they get away, or they get in a position where it's harder to capture them. And it depends on what they did, too. And most of the time, you're not even talking about, you know, murderers or people that are a danger to others. Now, if they're a danger to others, if somebody's holding a knife to somebody else's throat or something like that, that usually doesn't happen. That's in the movies. But if they're a danger to others, fine, because it's about protecting people. If you have to kill them to protect other people, then I don't have an issue with that. But it's not to protect other people in a sense that you're sitting there making that decision on your own. Like, oh, well, if I don't kill them, potentially they might. No, there's no potentially nothing. There's right there at that moment. Or if somebody's, you know, a serial killer, if they get away, they're probably going to kill somebody else or something along those lines. Not someone who's selling drugs or somebody who has warrants because they didn't pay their fucking tickets, or even a robbery if it wasn't an armed robbery. If you're dealing with people who aren't violent, there's other ways to approach things. And I'm not saying I have all the answers. I'm not. But what I am saying is that you have the government murdering people for doing things that they never agreed to. Meaning, like, if you don't pull over, there was a guy who was killed because he didn't pull over. He got away, and then he started, they cornered him off, and then he started backing up into the police cars. And, you know, of course, they started shooting at him. Now, he was at a stop. He wouldn't have been able to go fast enough to probably even hurt them. They could have backed up too, but no, they chose to just shoot him. So even something like that, if you don't pull over, and when did we all agree to all these ridiculous fucking laws? Because I never consented to any of these laws. I was just born here and I'm expected to obey all these laws. A new law gets passed every fucking day. And we're all really slaves of a government that rules by violence. They rule by force, and the police are the enforcers, along with other law enforcement groups. They're just at the lowest level of enforcement, because they're enforcing on a city or town or county level, as opposed to then you get to the FBI and whatever. State police would be probably your next level, and you could, you know, draw a hierarchy type chart of, okay, here's, you know, at the top, and then, or go from the bottom up or whatever. But it's fucked up when they're doing all this and they have the right because they feel it's like they don't have to have any evidence. They don't have to nothing. They just have to feel like they're in danger. And what they tell each other is, we just need to, as long as we make it home tonight. And I had mentioned a quote from the Radley Balco book, Rise of the Warrior Cop, which is a very disturbing book, and I suggest everybody read it. I can't emphasize that enough, that you read that book, Rise of the Warrior Cop. It's a great book, but the information, and it goes back through history, and it's just a great book. But one of the officers that I would call, I guess, a good officer somewhat, because what he said was, it's not about you going home, it's about everybody else going home. So if you want to be a cop, you can't just on the fly shoot somebody because, oh, they could grab their gun and pull it out. That's the type of logic that the law covers for them, that if somebody has a gun in their pocket, if they put their hand, I mean, what are we talking about, the Wild West here? You have a gun pointed at them and you're worried about them going into their pocket, pulling out a gun and being able to shoot you. You can't wait till they actually have the gun in their hand, like they pulled it out of their pocket and then they're starting to make a motion, and before they point it at you, are you that fucking shitty, a fucking cop? Because that's gonna, you know, you just, like, they reach, bang. And again, it's not like the movies. And they even say in their reports, oh, we told them to drop the gun. And I know they're lying, because they don't tell people to fucking drop the gun. It's just bang, bang. There's no drop the gun. And there should be. I'm sorry. Unless you're fired at, except for, you know, a few exceptions, you should not be able to fire at people. So I'm going to take a break here. And just a reminder, I don't have any commercials on the show. So everything during the breaks, I call them breaks, but it's really clips that I find that are related to the topics. So a lot of time it's important information and it's good to listen to. I try to find the best, you know, well, sometimes if I'm in a rush, I'll grab some stuff. But for the most part, you know, I try to find some good stuff that is informative about what we're talking about. So I'm going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll talk about Micah Johnson and what happened with him, a little of his background. And then we'll go more into the media influence, which I didn't get to yesterday. I still want to talk about some of the distortions in the media, the police murders that they were protesting, and the conspiracy theories that are out there, which I don't know that I think that there were any conspiracies in this, although he must be a pretty good shot, but I don't know how many bullets he fired. I mean, if you think about it, 16 people, I mean, 11 injured and 5 killed. So if it was one bullet each, it'd be 16. Even if it was two, you know, that's only one magazine. That's not a lot of shots. And that would mean if he hit everybody. So I'm sure he fired a lot more shots than that. So it makes a lot more sense than when we talked about the Orlando shooting, where there was like 100 and something. If he would have hit everybody with every shot, I don't know what happened there, but there's no way it happened the way they said. So we'll talk about that as well, and then maybe I'll get into this Dylan Noble, who nobody talked about, 19-year-old kid who was unarmed and killed and in Fresno, California, and no one really talked about that. So obviously the media has an agenda. At first, remember, the media didn't talk about people getting killed by cops, period, until I think Ferguson was really the first time. And the only reason that they brought it up, I think, was because of the riots. Before that, you'd only hear it locally. So, like, if in your city somebody, the cops killed somebody, you'd hear about it on local news and that's it. But as far as a national story, you wouldn't hear about it. So they wanted people to think that cops didn't kill people. All the while, they're killing thousands of people, and the FBI doesn't even keep records on it. They admittedly didn't keep records on it. So we will be right back after this. Nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Come check us out there. And the show is 100% funded by me and my full-time day job. I put a lot of work into the show. I don't expect anybody to give me any money. I don't feel like anybody owes me, unlike some other people out there. However, I do have a PayPal account that I set up, and if anybody would like to donate, I don't think you can donate change. I tried, and the least I could do is a dollar, but I'd appreciate a dollar is fine. I'm sorry, I'd even appreciate 25 cents if you could do it. So you can try, but anything that anybody can spare, I would appreciate it. And I'm thankful that, you know, people even listen to my show, never mind if someone was, you know, to donate. So if you have extra money and you want to donate to the show, it would be helpful. If not, you know, I don't feel that anybody's obligated or anything like that. And I don't look down on people that, oh, you listen to my show and you didn't give me money. No, I understand, especially in these times where they say the economy's great, but it really is not. So definitely go out and buy some gold and silver. It's a good time to do that before the prices go way up. So we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
And joining us right now is Quanell X. He's the leader of the New Black Panther Party. Hello, Quanell. Welcome to the show.
Greetings to you and your listening audience, sir. And I'm the leader of the New Black Panther Nation, one of the founding Central Committee members of the New Black Panther Party.
Okay. I'm glad we cleared that up. Let me ask you, did you see any of the memorial service for the Dallas police officers today on TV?
I saw very little. I saw some of the president's comments.
Okay. And what'd you think of from what you saw?
I believe that the president is doing his best to try to appease both sides of this discussion and argument. I think he wants to appease those in the African-American community who are grieved and are hurting about cases of injustice. But he also wants to speak to those police officers that are grieving for the loss of their comrades and their families. I think it's a very difficult job. I think he was being very politically correct as he possibly could be. But I think that we're at a stage in this nation where political correctness is not really going to properly address the issue at hand.
What will address the issue at hand? What would you like to have heard the president say, or what would you like to see the president do?
I think that we really need more district attorneys to listen and to understand the vital role that they play in this. The people are asking for police officers that are not good. Those that make the mistakes, those that commit a crime, to be prosecuted the same way you prosecute a normal citizen. The citizens in the African-American community, the people, want to know and see that the police are not held to a different standard of justice, that no one is above the law, including those law enforcement officers who break the law. It is the duty of the district attorney's office across the nation to properly prosecute those cops who deserve to be prosecuted. And if there was seriously some conviction, then I don't think that we would see protest. And I don't think that we will see what we're seeing in this nation right now.
Well,
there are no convictions, you're seeing this.
Well, it's not that there are no convictions. And you talk about the DA. All the DA could do is bring it to a jury or a grand jury. Michael Brown case, it was Eric Holder himself after the cop was acquitted by a jury. The civil rights investigation was found that the whole black hands up, don't shoot was a lie. Eric Holder himself said that witnesses lied because they were afraid of retribution from the community. You had the Eric Gardner case went to a jury, and the jury said not guilty. You also had the Trayvon Martin, who wasn't a police officer.
No, I think you're wrong, sir. Those cases never went to a jury. What they went to a grand jury.
Well, that's right. Okay.
But 1 second, sir. District attorneys indict young black men all the time across America, never going to a grand jury. And their cases go to trial without ever going before a grand jury. The same thing should be done when we deal with cops.
Sean Bell in New York, Amadou Diallo in New York. Amadou Diallo, that trial was on TV, had a black foreman. Not guilty. I mean, it sounds like you want cops to be held to a different standard of justice, not the standard of justice that everybody else is held to. You want them, they have leeway because they have the right to use deadly force under certain circumstances. And that's what enters into it. If a cop perceives a threat to the public, to himself, or to a partner, he has a right or she has a right to use deadly force.
That standard has and needs to be changed. It can no longer be if a cop just perceives a threat. That needs to be changed.
Oh, what would you suggest? That he get shot at first?
No, because in many of these cases where they perceive there's a threat, there is no threat.
Really?
And when you take somebody's life, you can't give that back.
All right, so what would you how would you change it? That you got to be shot at first?
No, I believe that there must be a legitimate show of a threat, not a perceived one.
Well, what would a show of a threat be in your opinion? Give me an example.
A show of a threat would be someone having a gun in their hand, someone coming at an officer with a weapon. But if someone has a weapon in their hand, then that is a different standard, and that's an acceptable standard, in my opinion. But to just kill unarmed people because you perceive a threat, that's not right.
Well, you know what? Cops have a right to assume if you resist arrest, and cops have a right to assume that you are a threat to them once you become hostile. And they don't know if someone is armed. And cops have waited at traffic stops and elsewhere. Cops have waited that split second, and someone has pulled a gun on them, and they have died. Cops die, too. And as a matter of fact,
you're absolutely right. Cops die, too. But guess what? Citizens die just as much.
Well, then you don't confront.
Okay, just to clarify that, that's a bunch of bullshit. First of all, it's something between 35 and 40 cops that die. And, you know, I don't know of any specific story where a cop was shot because he wasn't being paranoid enough. Now, that doesn't mean it didn't happen, but the amount of cops that are getting shot, which is not many, it's unlikely. So that's a bunch of bullshit. And a lot more people are being shot. Obviously, it's something like 200 times as many, or I'd have to do the math. I think it's even more than that.
The police.
All,
then you cooperate with the police, Quinnell X.
I agree with you on that. You should cooperate. You should comply.
Well,
but at the same time, we've seen a number of cases on video where black men have complied and been shot, and they did comply.
Well, give me an example. Who?
The example of the young brother who just got killed in Minnesota. He complied.
Wait a minute. Wait, time out. The example in Minnesota, we don't.
That's
we didn't.
Right.
Wait. Quinnell, you said you saw it on video. All you saw on video was him after he was shot. How do you know he complied?
Right.
Wait a minute. Let me ask the question. How do you know he complied, Quinnell?
Sir, let me tell you something, man. That's the problem. The lady in the video, she was more calm, cool, and collected than the cop.
You
was.
Don't know he complied. You're going on her word. And you know what? I'll take the cop's word over hers.
Okay, I'm sure you will, sir. No problem. And I want to warn you. Things will not get better in this nation with that type of attitude.
Well, with your type of attitude, because you're guessing? You say you know for sure
guessing, sir.
You didn't see it, did you? You said video. You didn't see the shooting, did you? Did you?
When you see the Eric Garner tape.
No. Let's go back to what you brought up as an example.
He didn't break the law.
You brought up.
And the one
you, yes, he did break the law. He resisted arrest.
He complied.
Who? Eric Garner complied?
Hold on. Wait one second. How can you resist arrest when there was no reason to arrest him in the first place?
Doesn't matter. You just said comply. Quinnell, you just said you agree. Comply with the officer. That doesn't mean questioning if it's a legitimate reason to arrest you. That's not complying. That's resisting.
But an officer does not have the right to violate your constitutional rights.
Then you deal with that after. Then
you deal with your handcuffs.
Quinnell, then you deal with that after. So when you're insincere,
yes, sir,
when you said comply.
When you deal with it after, IAD has a 99% rate of exonerating cops and no one being punished when you do file a complaint.
All right, let me ask you about this. Can we play number 70? This is from August 12th, 2015, Sandra Bland, Walker County Jail in Texas. Play it.
No more pigs in my community.
Off the pig.
No more pigs in my community.
Off the pig.
Revolution has come.
Off the pig.
Time to pick up the gun.
Off the pig.
No more pigs in my community.
Off the pig.
No more pigs in my community.
Off the pig.
That's the group you represent? Off the pig?
No, those are brothers and sisters with whom we're under the same constitution. But do I agree with the saying, off the pig? No, because remember, a pig is somebody who thinks like that, not a police officer in a uniform. That's an old term. That's old language that is outdated that should not be used today, because a pig is a mindset, not a cop, because we have a problem with law enforcement officers.
So what would you say? Then what would you say? Off who? Off who?
When you say off the pig, you get many good cops.
Okay. All right. So what would you say? Off the what?
No. I would say down with killer cops.
Down? Does that mean take them down?
I would say down. No. Down means you got to pull them out of the ranks.
Okay.
You got to prosecute them and remove them.
What about this Mika Johnson?
You just don't kill them.
Finally, what about Mika Johnson, the guy who killed the cops in Dallas? Was he in your group?
His name is Micah Johnson.
I couldn't care less what his name is. But what was he in your group?
He was a member at one time. Yes, sir.
And you threw him out, supposedly?
Yes, I did.
Why?
Because we knew when the brother first joined the organization that he had recently returned from a tour in Afghanistan. And we could tell that this brother was suffering mentally, that he had some mental health challenges. And so I advised them after several weeks of his membership to watch him. And we tried to calm him down, but then after that, a couple of months later, he started speaking crazy again. And I attributed it to a mental health condition more so than anything else. I didn't think the man would ever go and just start killing cops. I didn't believe that.
Okay.
But I'm telling you, this man was mentally ill.
All right. Quinnell X, appreciate your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
After the Cleveland Browns home game on Sunday, the president of the city's police union called NFL player Andrew Hawkins, quote, pathetic, for wearing a T-shirt protesting two police killings earlier in the year. Hawkins, a Cleveland Browns wide receiver, however, is not apologizing for wearing a shirt that read, quote, justice for Tamir Rice, John Crawford, during warmups. Rice, a 12-year-old, was shot and killed last month by a Cleveland police officer while carrying a pellet gun. Crawford, 22, was fatally shot in that Ohio Walmart, as we mentioned, while holding an air rifle he got within the store. The Cleveland Police Union head, who is about to join me here tonight, not only disagreed with Hawkins' statement, but argued athletes had no business weighing in at all, saying, quote, it's pretty pathetic when athletes think they know the law. They should stick to what they know best on the field. The Cleveland police protect and serve the Browns Stadium. And the Browns organization owes us an apology. He continued in another statement, quote, he's an athlete. He's someone with no facts of the case whatsoever. He should stick to playing football and let us worry about law enforcement. Earlier today, Hawkins himself defended his decision.
My mom has taught me my entire life to respect law enforcement. I have family, close friends who are incredible police officers, and I tell them all the time how they are much braver than me for it. Unfortunately, my mom also taught me that just as there are good police officers, there are some not so good police officers that would assume the worst of me without knowing anything about me for reasons I can't control. As you all know, and it's well documented, I have a 2-year-old little boy. That little boy is my entire world. And the number one reason for me wearing the t-shirt was the thought of what happened to Tamir Rice happening to my little Austin scares the living hell out of me. And my heart was broken for the parents of Tamir and John Crawford, knowing they had to live that nightmare of a reality.
And as Hawkins talked about his respect for law enforcement, he did not back down from that original statement.
To me, justice means that the innocent should be found innocent. It means that those who do wrong should get their due punishment. Ultimately, it means fair treatment. So a call for justice shouldn't offend or disrespect anybody. A call for justice shouldn't warrant an apology.
Joining me now is Detective Jeffrey Fulmer, president of the Cleveland Police Patrolmen's Association. Good evening to you. You see the statement right there. Why should he or anyone have to apologize for stating their sincere views on police conduct?
Well, first off, he doesn't have the clear view of the police conduct. He's calling for justice on two officers that were called to do their job with a male that had a gun inside a park that they had to defend themselves and use deadly force on him. So it's not a call for justice. They were justified. And Cleveland police officers work with the Cleveland Browns hand in hand, and when he disrespects two of our officers, he's disrespecting everybody else.
But, okay, you guys disagree on that. Why should he apologize to you? Why shouldn't you apologize to him? You have a disagreement about the facts of the case and how to proceed.
Well, we're not apologizing to anybody. I mean, justice, calling for justice on two of our officers, through, you know, they need to do it to us because they're disrespecting our officers on a job we do hard every day and a job that two officers were put in a position to by a male's actions.
In the statement, you talk about providing, serving and providing security for the stadium. How is that relevant?
Well, a lot of police officers work there. We are with the Browns organization. When you talk about two of our officers, doing a justified shooting, you're talking about all of us. Any one of us could have been in that circumstance.
Sure, but I mean, are you implying that it's relevant somehow? Are you implying that that security would change because of this disagreement?
No, we wouldn't change. We're here for the community. We're here for the people that go to the Browns games. We're here for the public.
And when you say that he, as we read your statement, doesn't know the facts or the law, how do you apply that logic? Wouldn't that apply to any citizen who may not be a police expert but has some legitimate view of police conduct? I mean, don't you think at a certain point that this kind of reaction risks feeding the perception that some of these police unions or some folks here don't think they're accountable to public views?
You know, there's a video of this, and everything speaks for itself. Their action, the male's action, spoke for itself. I mean, the video clearly showed, and by the officer's statement, that they were justified in the deadly force.
You're saying the video clearly shows that the 12-year-old boy was an imminent lethal threat to the officers?
Oh, absolutely. I don't know if you didn't see it, but yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we have some of it up on the screen. We're showing it. I mean, there's tremendous disagreement about that. In a lot of cases, that would constitute probable cause for a crime unless there was a lethal threat to the officers. But ultimately, that isn't your call, is it? And it's not the athlete's call. That's a call that has to go through the criminal justice system. I guess what I'm trying to get at here from your statements and the reason why they've upset some people is that your statements seem to presuppose that the police union or police officers have the final word on the facts here. You know that's not true. You know we have a system here of criminal justice that leaves that decision up to grand juries and the criminal justice process, right? And people are free to talk about it.
They're free to talk about it, but it shouldn't be talked on a football field where we are supporting the Browns by doing security every day when we support the Browns.
Are you saying, this is what I'm trying to understand. You just said before, of course, it wouldn't change your approach. Why does your security that you provide, and police bravely provide security for entire cities, stadiums and not, why would that affect his free speech rights to voice an opinion here? I mean, you're not really answering that question.
He can voice his opinion, and that's fine, but I'm just saying that calling for justice for his opinion on what happened that day, he's wrong. And that's what I'm clearly stating. And he was cleared by a city. These two were cleared by a city prosecutor already. This shooting was justified. And you know, like I said, it's a tragic that it was 12-year-old, but it was justified.
So to be clear, then, if you're saying he can state it, then are you withdrawing the request for an apology for him to state the view? Or he can state it, but he has to also apologize?
You know, I'm not saying, you know, I'm not withdrawing anything. You know, he disrespected police officers who were doing out there doing their job. He's surrounded by police officers. When you talk about two of us that were put in a situation like these two where you're talking about all of us.
And what do you think on just a more human level, if I can ask? You heard his statement talking about his child and these fears and a lot of people talking about that conversation around the country. Does your heart go out to people who are worried about their children unarmed losing their lives in these kind of incidents?
Well, it depends what you're saying, what's unarmed. I mean, this male was obviously he wasn't unarmed. He had what they thought to be a gun, and they also thought him to be 20 years old. If he's 20 years old, we're not sitting here today.
Sure, but you're well aware of many of the other cases. I know it's outside of your city, but the Eric Garner case or other cases. What do you think about the concern people have that folks are being killed in some cases by officers when there's less than a lethal threat posed?
How about this? Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. I think that eliminates a lot of problem. I have kids, too. They know how to respect the law. They know what to do when a police officer comes up to them. I think the nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
All right. Jeffrey Fulmer, we wanted to have...
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Welcome to everyone that tuned in at 7. We actually started early tonight, and I did post it in the event and on Twitter, but I'm sure a lot of people didn't get that note. So if you are tuning in now, you could always go back and listen to the first hour via the archives, which are on Spreaker, YouTube, iTunes, SoundCloud, among others. And you can get the list of those at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Also, every Monday, we have a new show that's been on 6 weeks now. Ellen Stallone hosts and produced The Illumination Hour, which is a very creative and entertaining show that's on at 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 o'clock p.m. Eastern every Monday. And you can listen to the archives at pretty much the same places where all the Nonpartisan Liberty for All archives are. The easiest place, of course, is to go to Spreaker and just select that show, and you can find all of the archives of the Illumination Hour. I had played that clip so many times because earlier I was talking about the attitude, and I'm talking about the last clip there, the attitude of police and online. And I even had once a cop go to my website and post stuff. And they have this attitude where you can't even talk to them about there being bad cops or they're doing things wrong, or it's just, you know, well, it's a hard job and we make mistakes. And it's not even that. It's like nothing they do is wrong. And that guy's attitude is pretty much the attitude of any cop that I've ever ran into or had any experience with. Not to say that that means that every cop has that attitude, but when you hear somebody like that talk, it makes you less sympathetic to what happened in Dallas. At least it does with me, because I think about cops that act like that and have the attitude of just do what we say, and as long as you do what we say, we won't kill you. And that's the exact same attitude Rudy Giuliani had it as well when I played the clip from him yesterday. And again, you need to be able to stand up for your rights. Cops don't have the right to do whatever they want. So this whole do whatever they say and then take care of it in court is bullshit. I mean, the things that they've done, like cavity search women on the side of the road, you know, you don't have to comply with things like that. But they intimidate people. They lie. They're trained liars. And they try to intimidate you into doing what they want. I mean, the best thing to do is just not answer any questions and take it from there. But to just do whatever they say is a ridiculous statement. So anyway, I had said before the break that there's still a bunch of things that I want to get to. One of them being the alleged shooter. I guess I say alleged because I heard his body was so burned that they could barely identify him. But I believe that pretty much even the family has accepted that he was the shooter. Now, whether he was the only shooter or not, I think that remains to be seen. They still have an open investigation, from what I understand. It could find other people at some point. But as I was saying before the break, based on the number of shots and hits, or at least bullets that hit people, it does sound possible, especially being former military. So what we know about him, he was 25 years old. They're saying right now, at least as of now, that he was the only shooter. Five cops were killed, 11 were injured. He had no ties to any groups at that time. He was a member of, if you had heard the first clip, of a new Black Panther group at one point, and they had kicked him out and thought that he had some mental issues there. But at the time, he wasn't a member of any group. And I don't understand, or I'm not totally clear on this, but the police had said he was angry at Black Lives Matter, but other people reported that he supported Black Lives Matter. So I don't know. It would sound like he supported Black Lives Matter, but maybe he didn't support their tactics and he was angry at them. And really, to be honest with you, and I've said this before, simply protesting, and, you know, I'm not saying don't protest, because they're getting media coverage, and that's important. And if you get media coverage, that's when it does make a difference. If you're just being ignored, then it really doesn't. I don't understand why the police keep showing up to protest, number one. I was at a protest. There was probably only 100 people, if that. And no police were there. And they come there, and then look what happens. They end up getting shot. So I don't see any need for them to be there. People don't need protection, especially if you have that many people. I mean, are there threats being made to Black Lives Matter where they ask for the police to be there? Because that would be pretty fucked up and really kind of contradict what they're saying, in my opinion. If you're asking for police to protect you, when, you know, get your own private fucking security. If Black Lives Matter is worried about any danger coming to the protesters, then hire your own fucking private security, number one. And I don't know that that's the case. I'm assuming the police just showed up there because they knew there was going to be a protest. And I don't think there's any need for the police to be there unless they get a call that something happens. If, like in Ferguson or in Baltimore, when buildings were burnt and things like that, if things like that happen, then fine. But the police are more instigators. At least they were in those other circumstances. Now, I don't know that they were in Dallas, but look what happened from them being there. So they don't need to be at protest. You have the right to protest without being fucking watched by police. So unless Black Lives Matter asked the police to be there, in my opinion, they should not be there. There's no need for them to be at a protest, again, unless it breaks out into violence. And if Black Lives Matter actually asked for them to be there, then that's pretty fucked up, because you're kind of contradicting your whole protest there. In Baton Rouge, there were over 160 people arrested. This was after, I believe, the cops were killed in Dallas. It was over the weekend. They were protesting the murders of Alton Sterling and I have the other name written down. I know it's an original name. I guess I'll put it that way. Philando Castillo. So they were protesting their murders, and in Baton Rouge was where I believe Alton Sterling was killed. So they were especially protesting that. Of course, the police show up. I don't know what they were arresting people for. I've heard that a lot of the arrests were for ridiculous things like, you know, obstruction of traffic or things like that, and that they were trying to get people out of jail, supposedly. The police had said they were trying to get people out of jail as soon as possible. But again, the police showing up, what does that do? It's especially the way they showed up in Missouri. I mean, they showed up totally in riot gear, with tanks, with all of that stuff. So I don't think that the police should be anywhere near there. If they want to monitor it from pretty far away, where they can see something like, you know, they're somewhere with binoculars where they can see if something does happen and they want to be on standby or something like that, that's fine. But they should not be there at the protest. I think that's a violation of people's rights, but who gives a fuck? They don't. Of course, the government doesn't. But, you know, if you protest, you have to have police there, of course. And that just causes more trouble. And then they blame the protesters. Well, protesters did this and they did that. Well, yeah, they're mad at the police. They're protesting the police. So that's the last people that they want to see is the police. So it's ridiculous that they're there from the beginning at these protests. And again, look what happens. So stay away from the fucking protests. And, you know, because that's what's going to happen. You can't clash with police, because that's the words they used in this article if police are not there. So that's kind of my, I guess, two cents on that, is that police should not be at the protests. If something happens, again, like someone's store being burnt down or something, if a criminal activity happens where they need to come there, then fine. Otherwise, they're protesting. And I'm trying to think if in the past for other types of protests, if police were there. Some cities have ordinances that you have to get permits for a certain amount of people, or police have to be there. I know there was ordinances regarding amounts of people. So, like, not for protests, but for gatherings, that if you had some kind of gathering in a, like, I remember this because of like school dances that had a certain amount of people, they had to have at least one unit there or something like that. And of course, they get paid for it. It's such extortion. And going back to what that in that clip of that cop, and the reason why a lot of these cops have these fucking attitudes, because they know that they're not going anywhere. The police have a monopoly on force. You can't go and call somebody else. The government has made it so there's only one form of law enforcement, and that's the government's. Now, there's private security, and that's how I think it should be, is it should be all security and no police and nobody with extra rights. And if you want to have police, then take away all those rights. Of course, that will never happen. They want to give them more rights. So going back to Micah Johnson, so the police had said that he was upset with white people and wanted to kill white people, especially white officers, and that's where they said he was upset about Black Lives Matter. And it didn't make sense about they tried to emphasize white people, of course, because the propaganda, he hates white people. It's white people. But his stepmother, first of all, is white. She was adamant about the fact that there's no way he hates white people. He has come to family reunions with her side of the family, which is all white, that she loves him and had nothing but good things to say about him. And that, you know, that's what the police say. So who knows? Just because the police say something doesn't mean shit to me. They also say, like I said, that he was upset with Black Lives Matter. Now, it didn't go into any more detail than that and why he was upset about Black Lives Matter. And it may have been that he thought that they weren't doing enough, or just protesting wasn't enough or something like that. And I'll get back to what I was talking about protesting in a minute, but he was a former reserve, I think Marines. But he did do a tour in Afghanistan. So it was at the time where they were using the reserves. And he, you know, another thing that Dr. Boyce something had said is that how you go to Afghanistan and, you know, kill a bunch of people, you don't know you're a hero, but he went and killed cops who are oppressing people. They're not just killing people. That's, I think, something that some people don't understand. because you're not hearing anything about that because, you know, they're murdering so many people that all of these other things are nothing compared to murder. So all the violations of rights or beating people up or whatever, they're not as serious as killing somebody. So you don't hear about that. But the police in general are oppressing people on a daily basis in so many different ways. And people are angry and people are frustrated. And it doesn't, the system doesn't do anything about it. They don't get in trouble for it. They're not treated like the average person. They have special rights and they essentially have a license to kill. And the way to solve it is not through the system, because that's not going to do anything. And really, that's where I believe noncompliance comes in, and self-defense as well. And I believe you have the right to defend yourself against a government agent. Now, obviously, what he did was not self-defense. He could look at it that way, I guess, because he could say, well, if those cops were oppressing people, they can't do that now. However, I don't know if he even knew who he shot, if he knew anything about them. And at the same time, it's still, it doesn't make it okay. And that's the whole thing. Even though I understand, I don't condone what he did and think that's okay. But at the same time, I understand to an extent what he probably was feeling when he did that. Now, he also could have just been, like the other guy said, they thought he was mentally ill, and maybe he was as well. And that's why, you know, there's a difference where he could have thought about something like that and then actually doing it. And he may have after the army, and his mother had said that he was or a stepmother, that he was a constitutionalist, and he went to the army and he saw that it's not about the government's not about the Constitution. He probably saw a lot of stuff and became aware of a lot of things with the government and realized that it's all a bunch of bullshit. You know, and I'm speculating, but maybe that's what had happened. And I don't know. But I don't believe any resolution or any thing is going to change in a pro-freedom way, at least. I think things are going to change for the worst through the system. And I think that as they try to pass more oppressive laws, one, people need to stand up for their rights and need to stop complying with some of these laws that they have no right to push on people. And in the not complying, if they need to defend themselves, then to defend themselves. And that's the only thing I support. I don't support violence in general. I'm not a peace person, but I'm not a violent person neither. When I was younger, I got in a lot of fights, and most of it was standing up for myself. But I don't believe in violence for the sake of violence. I believe in violence to save your life. And I don't really call it violence when it's saving your life, when it's a self-defense situation. So, and as far as people talk about civil wars and things like that, and now they're talking about a black-white civil war, which is ridiculous. which is totally media created and would never happen because that's what it is. It would be a media created civil war, but a civil war, people against the government, I wouldn't support that neither, because it would just be the same thing again. Somebody else would take over and you'd have the same oppression. I do believe in getting the truth to people and getting hearts and minds, and the truth is on my side, and I know that, and letting people know what's going on. And the more people that know and understand, if you get to a point where a certain percentage of people see what's really going on and they say, we're not going to do this, you get to a point where you can't arrest everybody. And that's, I think, the best way to go, of course, and the nonviolent way to go. And I think either way, it's best to try to stay nonviolent. However, at the same time, self-defense, again, I don't believe is violence, but I do support self-defense. And I think that at some point, as these laws become more and more oppressive, and they are, that people are going to have to defend themselves if they want any type of freedom. I really do. Now, again, I don't support something like what he did, but at the same time, I understand where he's coming from. But I don't know that it will do anything positive. As I was saying yesterday, I don't think it's going to stop cops from killing people or make them think twice or anything like that. However, I do think that if everyone defended themselves in situations that they were warranted to, that would change a lot of things. Now, at first, it wouldn't, but I think after a while, it would change a lot of things, and hopefully there would be more, it would be more of standoffs as opposed to people getting hurt. I remember in the movie with the Black Panthers, where they patrolled their neighborhood, and if the police were violating people's rights, they had guns and they stopped. And there was a scene where they stopped and they were beating up a guy and they pulled out their guns, and there was a standoff and the cops let the guy go and gave them to him. But nobody got shot or nobody got hurt, just like the Bundy Ranch. Nobody got shot, nobody got hurt. And that's, in theory, if people are actually thinking how it should go, because they should realize that they are violating people's rights. But they're teaching cops, essentially, if you disobey, what was the saying, comply or die, basically. That's the attitude of the police. And I think that people in general wouldn't even try to defend themselves if it came down to a situation where they had the right to, because they automatically think that they would get killed right there, killed later by the police, or, go to jail for defending themselves. So as far as the protests go, I mean, that's the positive side to the protest, is that it's getting media attention, so people are seeing it. On the other side of that is the media is distorting it. It's all they're making, because not everybody's marching about just racism. They're marching against the police and against the police killing people and against the police violating people's rights. But it's not getting the coverage that would be more important or more necessary to make a difference. So I think in that sense, yeah, it still makes a difference because it gets covered, but I don't know how much a difference it really makes. And ultimately, if it's going to change things, it will be people, you know, police, as I was saying earlier, police getting, you know, training in some kind of racial training, or the police becoming federalized, which creates an occupying army in the U.S., which they're almost federalized already. It's just not official. So that's the negative part to that, because nobody's focusing on changing the police or getting rid of the police or taking away their rights, or that's the last thing they're thinking about. So, and these protests aren't doing anything to make them think about that. So in general, I think protests, you know, I tell people, do whatever you want to do. If protesting is what you think is best, it's your thing, then do that. I don't criticize people for what they do. I think they should do whatever they think is best. At the same time, you know, just giving my opinion, if it doesn't get any attention from the media, if nobody hears about it, it doesn't really do much. And in this case, yes, it's getting attention from the media, but it's not getting the attention that it should be getting. So as I talked about, I mean, the real story here is that this is the people against the police. I talked about earlier, for those who missed the first hour, about in the past month, about four or five white people that have been killed by the police. One, an unarmed 19-year-old. And then one, an older man who the police went to the wrong house and he went outside with his gun and they shot him and killed him. And there's a couple other ones that are, they didn't have guns. It's suspect. One was a guy in prison where I think they made it look like a suicide, and it looks like the guards killed him. One guy, they claim he had knives, so they shot him and killed him. But you never know, because that's what the police say. They could put a knife in somebody's hand and say, oh, yeah, he came at us with a knife, so we killed him. I mean, so I don't want to, as I was saying earlier, I don't want to have to do that and break it out, because really, it's like I said, I'm not looking at race. I'm looking at the police are killing people and violating their rights, and they're the enforcers for the government, and they're going to be passing more and more oppressive laws. And, you know, just bringing up race is not going to do anything. It's going to do the two things I had mentioned earlier, federalize the police and maybe give them some kind of training when it comes to race. And that's not going to change nothing. So the media, I call government media, even on both sides are talking about this. You know, on one side, they're talking about how, oh, the cops aren't racist. Of course, like on their side, it's like there's no, they look at it as if there's no problems. So there's no problems with the police. They don't do anything wrong, whatever. Then the other side is, yeah, the police are racist and that's the issue and they need to not be racist. But it's not getting to the root of the problem. What it's doing is dividing people instead of everybody getting together and saying, we need to take this power away from the police. It's a monopoly that they have on force. And I believe they should end police totally and have private security companies where, like the Detroit Threat Management Center, where they provide security for people that can't afford it. And then for people that can, you know, you pay a monthly fee or something like that. And essentially, they have a reason, one, to give you the best customer service, be the best they can be. They can't just murder people because they'll be charged with murder. They won't have the same rights that the police have and protections. And then if you don't like them, then you fire them and get somebody else. There's no monopoly on force. There's a bunch of different companies. And that's why the police, another reason why the police are able to not only get away with what they get away with, but they have no incentive to get better. They have no incentive to treat people better or not kill people or not violate their rights or harass them, because that's all you have. And a lot of people have the attitude like, oh, fuck, if the police were gone, we're screwed. Well, for one, if you live in a state where you can buy guns, I mean, you can pretty much protect yourself. It's not as dangerous as people want you to think it is. Of course, on the news, they want you to think it's dangerous. So all they cover is all the bad stories, which is a small percentage, a very small percentage of what happens. And if you feel you need security, then again, you hire a security company. Now, if there weren't all these taxes being taken out for things like police, among other things, then you would have that money to hire a security company. And one that would be based on the philosophy of the Detroit Threat Management Center, like how they put people first. They put protection and safety, and that's what it's about. Because really, what do you want police for? You want police to be safe and protected, really. I mean, and they don't do that anyway. They show up after the fact. How many times do you call the police and, okay, if somebody gets killed, they may solve the murder and put the person in jail? But again, that's after the fact. Or if somebody robs you, usually they don't give a shit about that. And there were police in the show I did last week about the 175 where they would take shit and then blame it on the robbery. Like if there was a story where there was money in the house, the cops took the money and blamed it on the robbery. So I would be scared to call the police if my house was robbed or broken into, because they'd be asking, well, what was, you know, taken, or, you know, looking around, and who knows what you might get a corrupt cop that might take something. I guess it depends what you have in your house. But if you don't have anything that valuable in your house, then if someone broke in, they probably wouldn't take anything anyway. But the other thing I had talked about earlier, the other thing that the media obviously doesn't do, is it's like they get a file. If someone's shot by the police and killed, they get a file on them about everything they've done. Now, when a cop gets killed, there's nothing bad about them. everything's great. You know, it doesn't matter if they were a corrupt cop, if they were a bunch of complaints against them. You're not going to hear any of that. So I really think that even with the race thing, that the majority of that is created by the media. I don't think the majority of people think that. I think they realize that police are killing people from all races, and that they're, you know, go to killedbypolice.org and you'll see it's Hispanic, white, black. There's definitely racism, and I don't think anyone's going to deny that. And I think black people are killed at a higher rate. And I had mentioned before that part of that, I believe, is that police think every black person's a criminal. So they're, you know, they're quick to pull out a fucking gun. But at the same time, they're going after everybody. And they're violating your rights, and they're doing whatever they want to do. If you don't sit there and kiss their fucking ass, if you stand up for your rights, you got to worry about being, you know, not only arrested, but maybe beaten, maybe even killed. I mean, I don't worry about at night when I drive around. I worry about the police. I don't worry about other, I don't say other criminals because I'm not a criminal, but I don't worry about criminals. I worry about the police, and I purposely don't go to certain places just because I've been harassed by police before and even arrested when I didn't commit a crime. Now, it was dropped by the DA like 3 days later, but that's who the real criminals are to me, the gang in blue. Those are the people you got to worry about. And when you got to worry about the people that are supposedly there to protect you, I think they took off to serve and protect off the cars because they don't serve and protect. And if you try saying that to them, the attitude that they'll get, or, you know, yell at you or whatever, you know, that you pay their salary and all that, you know, that's, they'll just ignore you or say that's bullshit, which obviously it's not. But you're forced to pay their salary. You don't have a choice. As I said, they have a monopoly on force. So some of the distortions, when I was watching some of the footage, I went back on YouTube and listened to some of the stuff that they were saying, that they wanted to make sure the citizens of Dallas were safe and that they were protecting the people. And even people on newscasts have said this, or maybe not newscasts, but whatever you want to call them, pundits, people that talk about the, I guess it would be people like me on TV, except for the fact that I tell the truth, but made the statement how it was Anderson Cooper yesterday. I'd mentioned this, that people all around America are moved by what the officers did. And there was a wife on there bragging, and the cops were the targets, not the people. So I know there was one woman who got hit, and that was probably by accident. It might have been a bullet that bounced up, or it possibly could have been the cops shot her by accident. And that happened before in the Boston bombing, when they had the supposed shootout where the facts changed about five times. First, they said they had a long gun. And then it came out a couple weeks later, oh, they only had a 9mm. Anyway, they said that they had shot one of the cops. And I'm not talking about the cop at the school. I'm talking about one of the cops that was there in the shootout that had lived. And it comes out 2 weeks later, oh, friendly fire, they had shot him. So whether they, and I doubt we'll ever know, because unless they do some ballistics testing on the bullet or they even have it, they won't know if he shot this woman or the police shot her. And I had played a clip from her yesterday, you know, of course, thanking the police. And I guess they said the police got on top of her or whatever. But I would want to get the fuck away from the police. I was saying this earlier, because they're the ones that are the targets. This is not, I know they're going to want to call it a mass shooting. And I talked about yesterday how they're going to exploit this and exploit it like they do everything else, meaning the politicians, things like gun control and call it a mass shooting and all of those type of things. And from that, they're going to use something like, well, you know, a civilian was hit too. Well, the civilian might have been hit by the police. So I don't think we're ever going to know or they're ever bring that up again. So she's sitting there thanking them, but they might have been the ones who had actually done it. And someone had made the comment that, oh, this was such a cowardly act. A cowardly act. So a guy with a gun goes up against the fucking police who call in SWAT teams, who have, I don't know how big the Dallas Police Department is, but it's probably huge. How is it to not be cowardly if he wanted to do that? Should he just walk right up to, I think one of them, he actually did walk right up to them. But, I mean, I wouldn't call that a cowardly act. And I'm not saying that, again, I envy what he did or anything like that, because I don't. Although I explained before that at the same time, I understand where, you know, the frustration comes from. But I would not call that a cowardly act at all. I would call a lot of what the police do as cowardly, because they can call in hundreds of men at any time, whereas he did this all by himself, supposedly, allegedly. Now, that could change. But I had said earlier, based on the amount of shots and people that were hit, there weren't a lot of bullets, at least hits. So even if he had missed, you know, a whole magazine full, it sounds plausible that there was one shooter. The other thing are, you know, the war on police. Police feel like they're being targeted. That's such bullshit. They've been saying that for years now. Things like this rarely happen. Yes, there have been in the past couple years a few police shootings. One was in Las Vegas where they were targeted. But the amount of them is maybe once a year, if that. So, and think about how many police there are in the country of 300 million people. So this whole war on police and police being targeted, they get mad if you criticize them. They get mad. If you're someone who's trying to hold them accountable, they get mad. And I was talking about earlier what they have written in their Facebook pages and in their Police One, I think it's called, where they actually verify if you're a cop. And these guys are just, the egos on them are just huge. They can't do nothing wrong. They can't be criticized. It's crazy. It's definitely a profession that certain people are attracted to. Either that or they've gotten rid of all the police that were humble or good police. Also, a senator said that the police sacrificed their own lives in this incident. And they didn't sacrifice their own lives. They were being targeted. So it's not like they tried to save people and sacrifice their own lives. They were there for a protest, which I had mentioned earlier, that there's no reason for them to be there for a protest. And they were the targets. So I don't see how they sacrificed their own lives in any way in this shooting. So we're going to take a break. I have some clips from the shooting that I had got from YouTube. So I'll play a few of those. When we come back, I still want to talk about the other two shootings that they were protesting, as well as the conspiracy theories, just briefly, although it doesn't seem like it's something that... Although it will help to push agendas, as I had mentioned, they already have a bill that's written up that's going to be submitted to make killing a police officer a federal crime, and they'll use it to militarize the police more. I went into that yesterday, how they're going to exploit it. But as far as being some kind of false flag or something like that, it doesn't sound like it was. And then I'll try to go into this shooting of this Dylan Noble, who, of course, nobody heard about because it doesn't help them with their narrative, them being the government. And, of course, on all of these news stations and all this media, it's all government media. And they're only going to talk about certain police killings. And again, I mean, they recently, in the past couple of years, started talking about them nationally. Before that, they didn't talk about them at all. And they've maybe mentioned, what, 8 in 2 years or 7 in 2 years, when there's been, in 2 years, almost 3,000. So obviously, as I had mentioned, if you live in that area, yes, you're going to hear about it on your local news. But besides that, it's not national. There's only certain ones that become national because they're trying to push a certain agenda and make it all about race. And the reason they're trying to make it all about race is because it takes the focus off of the police themselves, and the police themselves being bad, the police having too much power, and all of that stuff. So they're just looking at the problem as, well, the problem is the police are racist and we just need to fix that and everything's good. And no, that's not the problem. And it's not just the police, because the police are at the bottom. And I've mentioned this a couple times already. It's the politicians, it's the judges, it's the district attorneys. They're just as responsible, if not more, than the police. So if you're going to protest the police, you should be protesting all them too. But they want to, you know, they don't want to be held accountable for that, for the actions of the police. They don't want to be the ones targeted. But they're just as guilty as the police are, if not more. So be sure to check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We have a lot of stuff there, including original articles I call them articles/blogs. The current one I'm working on is a series on the legalization of drugs and why they should go back to how they were in 1914. As, of course, having self-ownership, you have the right to put whatever you want in your body without the government and the police kidnapping you and locking you up in a cage. So we will be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
The people who must be gathered on the opposite side, we have no means of give you a wider picture to give you some understanding.
Oh my God, please, officer, don't tell me that you just did this to him.
When should you shoot a cop? That question, even without an answer, makes most law-abiding taxpayers go into knee-jerk conniptions. The indoctrinated masses all race to see who can be first and loudest to proclaim that it is never okay to forcibly resist law enforcement. In doing so, they also inadvertently demonstrate why so much of human history has been plagued by tyranny and oppression. In an ideal world, cops would do nothing except protect people from thieves and attackers, in which case shooting a cop would never be justified. In the real world, however, far more injustice, violence, torture, theft, and outright murder has been committed in the name of law enforcement than has been committed in spite of it. To get a little perspective, try watching a documentary or two about some of the atrocities committed by the regimes of Stalin or Lenin or Chairman Mao, or Hitler, or Pol Pot, or any number of other tyrants in history. Pause the film when the jackboots are just about to herd innocent people into the cattle cars, or just about to gun them down as they stand on the edge of a ditch, and then ask yourself the question, when should you shoot a cop? Keep in mind, the evils of those regimes were committed in the name of law. And as much as the statement may make people cringe, the history of the human race would have been a lot less gruesome if there had been a lot more cop killers around to deal with the state mercenaries of those regimes. Now, people don't mind when you point out the tyranny that has happened in other countries, but most have a hard time viewing their own country, their own government, and their own law enforcers in any sort of objective way. Having been trained to feel a blind loyalty to the ruling class of the particular piece of dirt they live on, also known as patriotism, and having been trained to believe that obedience is a virtue, the idea of forcibly resisting law enforcement is simply unthinkable to many. Literally, they can't even think about it. And humanity has suffered horribly because of it. It is a testament to the effectiveness of authoritarian indoctrination that literally billions of people throughout history have begged and screamed and cried in the face of authoritarian injustice and oppression, but only a tiny fraction have ever actually lifted a finger to try to stop it. Even when people can recognize tyranny and oppression, they still usually talk about working within the system, the same system that's responsible for the tyranny and the oppression. People want to believe that the system will, sooner or later, provide justice. The last thing they want to consider is that they should illegally resist, that if they want to achieve justice, they must become criminals and terrorists, which is what anyone who resists legal injustice is automatically labeled. But history shows all too well that those who fight for freedom and justice almost always do so illegally, i.e., without the permission of the ruling class. If politicians think that they have the right to impose any law they want, and cops have the attitude that as long as it's called law, they will enforce it, What is there to prevent complete tyranny? Not the consciences of the lawmakers or their hired thugs, obviously, and not any election or petition to the politicians. When tyrants define what counts as law, then by definition, it is up to the lawbreakers to combat tyranny. Pick any example of abuse of power, whether it's the fascist so-called war on drugs, the police thuggery that has become so common, the random stops and searches now routinely carried out in the name of security, such as at airports, border checkpoints that aren't even at the border, sobriety checkpoints, and so on, or any other example. Now ask yourself the uncomfortable question. If it's wrong for cops to do these things, doesn't that imply that the people have a right to resist such actions? And of course, state mercenaries don't take kindly to being resisted, even non-violently. If you question their right to detain you, interrogate you, search you, invade your home, and so on, you are very likely to be tasered, physically assaulted, kidnapped, put in a cage, or shot. If a cop decides to treat you like livestock, whether he does it legally or not, you will usually have only two options: submit or kill the cop. You can't resist a cop just a little and get away with it. He will always call in more of his fellow gang members until you are subdued or dead. Basic logic dictates that you either have an obligation to let law enforcers have their way with you, or you have the right to stop them from doing so, which will almost always require killing them. Politely asking fascists to not be fascists has a very poor track record throughout history. Consider the recent Indiana Supreme Court ruling, which declared that if a cop tries to illegally enter your home, it's against the law for you to do anything to stop him. Aside from the patent absurdity of it, since it amounts to giving thugs with badges permission to break the law and makes it a crime for you to defend yourself against a criminal if he has a badge, consider the logical ramifications of that attitude. There were once some words written on a piece of parchment, those words now known as the Fourth Amendment, that said that you have the right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures at the hands of government agents. In Indiana today, what could that possibly mean? The message from the ruling class is quite clear and utterly insane. It amounts to this: we don't have the right to invade your home without probable cause, but if we do, you have no right to stop us, and we have the right to arrest you if you try. Why not apply that to the rest of the Bill of Rights while we're at it? You have the right to say what you want, but if we use violence to shut you up, you have to let us. I can personally attest to the fact that that is the attitude of the U.S. so-called Department of Justice. Or maybe, you have the right to have guns, but if we try to forcibly and illegally disarm you and you resist, we have the right to kill you. Ask Randy Weaver or the Branch Davidians about that one. You have the right to not testify against yourself, but when we coerce you into confessing and call it a plea agreement, you can't do a thing about it. What good is a right? What does the term right even mean if you have an obligation to allow jackboots to violate your so-called rights? It makes the term absolutely meaningless. To be blunt, if you have the right to do A, it means that if someone tries to stop you from doing A, even if he has a badge and a politician's scribble, sometimes called law, on his side, you have the right to use whatever amount of force is necessary to resist that person. That's what it means to have an unalienable right. If you have the unalienable right to speak your mind, a la the First Amendment, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to shut you up. If you have the unalienable right to be armed, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to disarm you. If you have the right to not be subjected to unreasonable searches and seizures, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to inflict those upon you. Those who are proud to be law-abiding don't like to hear this and don't like to think about this, but what's the alternative? If you do not have the right to forcibly resist so-called legal injustice, That logically implies that you have an obligation to allow government agents to do absolutely anything they want to you, your home, your family, your neighbors, and so on. Really, there are only two choices. You are a slave, the property of the politicians without any rights at all, or you have the right to violently resist government attempts to oppress you. There can be no other option. Of course, on a practical level, openly resisting the gang called government is usually very hazardous to one's health. But there's a big difference between obeying for the sake of self-preservation, which is often necessary and rational, and feeling a moral obligation to go along with whatever the ruling class wants to do to you, which is pathetic and insane. Most of the incomprehensible atrocities that have occurred throughout history were due in large part to the fact that most people answer never to the question of when should you shoot a cop. The correct answer is, when evil is legal, become a criminal. When oppression is enacted as law, become a lawbreaker. And when those violently victimizing the innocent have badges, become a cop killer. So the next time you hear of a police officer being killed in the line of duty, take a moment to consider the very real possibility that maybe in that case, the law enforcer was the bad guy and the cop killer was the good guy.
We begin tonight with that chilling piece of video live streamed on Facebook in the moments after a man is shot by police. His girlfriend in the car pulling out her phone and then capturing the moments right after. Her exchange with the police officer, now seen by millions across this country. The pictures coming in now here in New York City of protesters gathering near Union Square. And just a short time ago, the governor of Minnesota asking, would this have happened if those passengers were white? He said, I don't think so. We begin with ABC's Gio Benitez in Minnesota.
Stay with me.
This is Diamond Reynolds streaming live on Facebook from her cell phone just moments after her boyfriend, Philando Castile, was shot by police during a traffic stop over what she says was a broken taillight. She says Castile told the officer he was carrying a licensed gun.
He's licensed to carry. He was trying to get out his ID and his wallet out his pocket, and he let the officer know that he had a firearm and he was reaching for his wallet, and the officer just shot him in his arm.
The police officer pointing his gun into the car, Reynolds calm and clear, her young daughter in the back seat.
We're waiting for a back. I will, sir. No worries. I will. He just shot his arm off. We got pulled over on Larpiner.
I told him not to reach for it. I told him to get his hand off
it. You told him to get his ID, sir, and his driver's license. Oh my God, please don't tell me he's dead. Please don't tell me my boyfriend just went like that.
Keep your hands where they are, please.
Yes, I will, sir. I'll keep my hands where they are. Where's my daughter? You got my daughter?
Then officers, guns drawn, order Reynolds out of the car.
Get on your knees. Get on your knees.
Now on the ground, she never stops live streaming.
They threw my phone, Facebook.
Police perform CPR on Castile on the street. Reynolds now detained in a patrol car, her cell phone still recording.
I don't know if he's okay or if he's not okay.
Her daughter still with her. Reynolds finally breaks down.
I can't really do because they got me handcuffed.
It's okay, Mommy.
I can't believe they just did this. I'm
It's okay. I'm right here with you.
Philando Castile, a supervisor at a school cafeteria where kids loved him, was taken to the hospital and died. Diamond Reynolds says she was held by police until 5 o'clock this morning.
This is where the shooting happened. I'm told it's usually a quiet neighborhood. People have been gathering here since the incident, and just take a look at what they're posting. Film the police.
Reynolds today explaining why she did just that.
I didn't do it for pity. I didn't do it for fame. I did it so that the world knows that these police are not here to protect and serve us. They are here to assassinate us. They are here to kill us because we are black.
Later, she got a face-to-face apology from Minnesota Governor Mark Dayton.
I can't tell you how sorry I am. The terrible tragedy that's been forced on you and on your family.
I don't want want you guys to be sorry. I want y'all to be more careful.
We want justice.
And late today, this statement from the governor.
Would this have happened if those passengers, the driver and the passenger, were white? I don't think it would have. This kind of racism exists.
And Gio Benitez is with us from St. Paul, Minnesota tonight. And Gio, what do we know about the police officer at the center of the case?
Well, David, that officer has not yet been identified, but we know that he's on paid leave at home, and investigators did speak with him this afternoon. David.
Gio Benitez leading us off tonight. Thank you, Gio.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. And for those of you who joined us late, as we had started early tonight, I had started at 6. Right after the show, the archives will be posted on Spreaker, YouTube, SoundCloud, and you can actually get a list and the actual specific URLs at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com if you want to go back and listen to the first hour. So that last clip was the actual shooting of Philando Castile. It wasn't the shooting, it was immediately after. She probably should have, and everyone should do this, but I know that you don't think to do it, or you may be nervous or whatever, but before, you know, as you're getting pulled over, before the cop actually comes to the door, you should have a camera out, especially if somebody else is with you, because then it makes it a lot easier. So you could see blood all over his shirt and his arm. And they asked the question, and this is the one that happened in Minnesota. So supposedly she says it was a broken taillight. I guess their taillight wasn't broken, but that's probably what they told her. And supposedly they had said that he looked like a suspect from a robbery. I haven't heard any more information on that. Either way, he also had a permit to carry. As far as I know, that has been verified. But he didn't have to even tell the cop. I don't know how his gun was concealed, but it's like telling the cop if the cop wasn't going to see it. I mean, I don't know how it was concealed. So it could have been in the same pocket as his wallet, or he would have had to expose it getting his wallet or registration or something like that. I don't know. And maybe that's why he had told him, but I wouldn't tell him. I did once, but I will never do that again. Not that anything bad came out of it. I had the cop asked, and I had told him, and you know, he just verified it and gave it back to me. But that was about it, because that was in Clark County when you still had to register handguns. Now you don't. So I don't know what they would do now. Just verify that I don't have any felonies or something. Anyway, that was years ago. So I wouldn't answer any questions, to be honest. If it was something where I was accused of a crime, I would say I haven't committed any crimes, but I'm exercising my right to remain silent, because you never know. You could come across a cop that may use that to fuck with you, or may not. You don't know what they're going to do. And they like to ask a lot of questions, and most of those questions, they have the right to ask anything they want, but you have the right not to answer. The only person that can force you to answer a question, and they really can't force you, but at least punish you, I guess, I'd say, for not answering a question as a judge. They can find you in contempt of court. But from what I understand, he told a cop that he had a gun, and the cop doesn't deny that in the video, and that he was reaching for his license, and he shot him. Now, would that have happened if he was not black was a question that came up. And I don't know. I mean, there are, as I had mentioned at the beginning of the show, I mentioned 5 murders in the past month of white people by cops. One of them, again, being a 19-year-old who was unarmed. Now, I think it depends on the circumstances, but based on those circumstances where they knew he had a gun, and they thought that he was a robbery suspect, if it was all the same circumstances, they probably would. Now, the thing that I had mentioned is, I think what happens, and there's definitely a racial element, but again, it's about the police. The police are coming after everybody. They're violating everybody's rights. They're killing every race of people. This is not just about black people, which it's a media fucking circus now, and that's what they have totally turned it into. And it's just, it's to the point now where they're not, as I had mentioned all through the show, where they're not even talking about doing anything really about the police except things so they can reduce racism, really. And that's it. And that's what they want. And federalizing the police, which, again, they pretty much have done that. And they've gotten all this training from the police. And they got all the tanks and the automatic weapons. So the federal government is already controlling the police. So they think federalizing will all of a sudden make them, you know, change things, which is crazy. But that's where it's making things worse. But all the same circumstances, he probably would have shot him as well. But that's not to say that they don't shoot black people at a higher percentage, which I've said before, because I think a lot of cops think all black people are criminals, essentially, especially young black people. So in that case, they never came out and said that he was the suspect. So I would assume it's not him. He just happened to look like him. And there's really, you know, no excuse here. And I think same thing. It may go to a grand jury. And if it does, it probably won't go to trial. And again, if it goes to trial, they'll probably be found not guilty. What people don't realize or think about is the instructions that the judges give, number one, to juries, and which they're part of government. They're in on it. There is no justice. And the DAs don't want to convict these cops. So it's like throwing a case. I mean, they're not going to be into it. They don't want to convict a police officer. So those are two reasons right there why they never get convicted. So who knows what's going to happen here? Because of the governor, there might be some pressure there, but I seriously doubt it. Now, if killing a cop, killing someone was a federal offense, like they just introduced the bill that killing a cop is going to be a federal offense, then they could investigate that. Now, what they're trying to do, I don't agree with, because I don't think that this should even exist, that they have the federal government really invented the, not invented, but created the hate crime law so they could get involved when the state doesn't. And at one point, like during the Mississippi burning days, if you've seen that movie, it made sense. But there shouldn't be a extra, you know, murder. And someone was saying this pretty much how I'm saying it, because I agree with them. Murder is murder. I don't know that you need to tack on, well, he also murdered the person with intent of, you know, he had hate as well. I mean, murder pretty much is going to cover anything that you do that is serious enough. The punishment is serious enough that you don't need to add on their interpretation of what they were thinking. So for these cases, the federal government, all they can do is say they were hate crimes or civil rights violations, which never usually go through because you can't really prove that. You can't prove that he shot him because he was black, and it shouldn't be going through the federal government anyway, unless they pass a law. And I wouldn't, based on the way things are now, I wouldn't be against this. If they passed a law, if a cop kills somebody, it's a federal offense, then that's fine. Then the federal government can start investigating fucking police that murder people. Now, I think you'll still get to the same result, that they'll get off anyway. But at least that's something. As it is now, they can only investigate civil rights violations. So right away, they can only investigate when black people get killed or when black people's rights get violated, and they have to somehow prove the that motivation. And that's pretty hard to do. However, they're, of course, looking more at protecting police, who, again, there's, what, 30 to 40 murders per year of police. And the majority of those, as I had mentioned before, are things where police are chasing somebody that just committed a robbery and they shoot back at them. There was a couple days ago, somebody tried to escape. I think it was at a courthouse in Michigan, and I believe shot a cop. I don't know if they died or not. So things like that. And there was another one, too, where somebody carjacking and they shot at the police. And I don't know if they killed them. But that's the type of shootings or type of situations where people are killed. Police are killed. As far as being targeted, it's very rare. And as I had mentioned, in the past 3 years or 4 years, there's about three of them, and one of them is, of course, what just happened in Dallas, the one that happened here in Las Vegas, and then the one in New York. And New York hadn't had an officer killed in years at that point. So this, it's just ridiculous how the distortion compared to the reality when it comes to police. And how people buy this bullshit. And that's why when you look at something like what happened in Dallas, I don't condone it. I don't agree with it. I don't think that it's okay. But I understand the frustration and the rationale of that. Now, that doesn't mean, you know, I think people should go and do that, because I don't. But there's probably, in a lot of people, feelings of hopelessness, like nothing's going to change. Because, as I've said, nothing's going to change through the system. There's not, you know, I was listening to a radio show today, and they had mentioned, you know, there's not some messiah that's going to become president and everything's going to be great again. And I'm totally referring to true freedom and liberty and having that. It's going the other way. All your rights that you have left, which aren't many, and you might not even know because they pass laws all the time that you might not even know about, but more and more, your rights are being taken away. They keep passing more and more laws. How many laws do you need? How old? I mean, think about how old the country is. And each year, more and more laws. And I brought up before, well, if you want to introduce a new law, then you need to get rid of an old law. And you never hear anybody. I'll give credit to the guy in Minnesota, at least for bringing up what he did, criticizing the police. Now, he's going to get a whole bunch of shit because usually no one will criticize the police. The mayor of New York kind of did, not really. And the governor of Minnesota even saying that, the police are going to take offense to that and saying, well, you're calling us racist. They will. And if people forget what happened in New York, the mayor of New York, all he said was, because his son is half black, his wife is black, and that he's going to have to explain to his son, you know, about being careful around police. And the police got totally offended. At a funeral for those two officers, they turned their back on the mayor, and they were all pissed off, saying the mayor's not supporting them. First of all, he really didn't say shit. He should have said a lot more than that. But that's how they are with their egos and their attitudes and how they feel. They have a sense of entitlement. I mean, even listening in that documentary about the cop who was a drug dealer and would protect drug dealers to 175, which I recommend you watch it. He was even saying like he felt untouchable. He felt on top of the world, like nobody could do anything to him. And it was because, I mean, it was partially because he got away with all the shit he got away with, but he got away with a lot of that stuff because he was a cop. Now, not that all cops get away with being criminals, because that's the one thing that they do go after cops for. But you don't know how many cops are criminals because we just, how would we know? And maybe only a small percentage they even go after. I mean, according to Serbico, who was a cop in the 70s, I mean, it was pretty much, you know, 90-something percent of New York. So the other shooting that they were protesting, and this was really hard to watch, the Alton Sterling. And I know, of course, they came up after and said, well, he had a record and this and that. One of the things that I think he had a warrant out for and was considered the worst thing he did. And I bet you that the majority of news organizations didn't go into any details on this because it does make a fucking difference, is that he was a sex offender. Now, you hear sex offender right away, you think, you know, this is a fucked up guy, rapist, child molester, whatever. When he was 20, he was with a 14-year-old. Now, I don't know about you, but there are a lot of girls that are 14 that get fake IDs and can get into clubs because they look like they're 21. So being 20 and being with a 14-year-old, I don't have any problem with that. So the other stuff, from what I recall, was minor shit. But he did have a gun on him, and I guess because he's a convicted felon, it was illegal for him to have a gun. However, what happened with him was they got a call, and this was the one in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. There was a call that somebody with a gun pulled a gun on someone, And the guy who called even said it wasn't him. He said that he knew him. He sold records outside or CDs outside of his store and that he was a good guy, at least in how he knew him. And then, of course, right away, what they do when somebody's killed by the police is they bring out, well, they had a record, they did this, they did that. And there were a couple other things, but it was nothing violent. I think there was something robbery, but not an armed robbery or anything like that. Like he stole something or something along those lines. And the, you know, statutory rape, which is a ridiculous crime, and putting people in jail for statutory rape. And again, he was 20 and she was 14. It's not like he was 50 and, you know, she was 14. But what happened, they said that he didn't comply, that they came up to him and told him to get on the ground. And that he had said, well, and this is basically what happened to me. I was asked to get out of my car and I don't know the reason why. So I'm like, well, why? What did I do? Why are you asking me to get on the ground? And of course, cops, they didn't ask me to get out of the ground. They asked me to get out of my car. And of course, cops, they're not going to tell you. They're not going to give you any respect of telling you why or what you did or anything like that. They're just get on the ground. And I guess they had grabbed him. They stun gunned him and got him on the ground. And then he did have, they say he had a gun in his pocket and that he reached for it. It doesn't look like he was reaching for it. And this is what I brought up earlier about the other shooting of Philando Castile. Not even him, just anybody in general. If you have a gun in your pocket and a cop is pointing a fucking gun at you, are you really that scared that he has enough time to put his hand inside his pocket, take out the gun and shoot you? You can't wait till he actually gets his hand in his pocket and gets the gun partially out or gets it out before you shoot him? No, they can't do that. So he just had his hand near his pocket. He didn't have it going in, even going into his pocket. And they just shot him right in the chest. I believe they shot him 4 times. And then again, of course, right after they release, you know, right away, sex offender, warrant for failing to register as a sex offender. They don't say, oh, statutory rape, a 20-year-old with a 14-year-old. But if you're a cop and you get killed, it's, oh, they were in the military and they had a family. And what about his family? What about his life? You know, who knows how long ago that was? I think he was 37. So if he was 20 then, and who knows what the last thing he did as far as crimes was. You know, he could have been somebody who turned his life around. Now, somebody had brought up, well, he's selling illegal CDs. Well, this is kind of fucked up. And I just was thinking of this as well, that you don't know if he's selling CDs that are the original CD or copies. Because I assume that as well, but of course they assume the worst and say that, like, he's breaking the law, he's selling copyrighted material. Well, nobody said that he was selling CDs of, you know, bootleg CDs. And nobody said he was selling, you know, what if he was selling CDs of somebody he knows and he's trying to sell their CD for them? You ever go to Venice Beach? You got like every fucking, you start walking down the boardwalk there, and everyone's trying to sell you their CD. So I guess he sold CDs outside of the store, and I don't know that that's what it was. He could have been selling bootleg CDs for all I know, which you would think that if he was, that they would have stopped him a long time ago. But he could have been selling CDs that were the original CD. So I don't know. Either way, it's irrelevant. Selling CDs illegally, if that's what he was doing, and not checking in as a convicted sex offender is not punishable by death. And being a suspect in a robbery because you happen to look like that person is not even a crime, first of all. Referring to Fernando Castillo. So both of these guys, no matter how you look at it, not only did not deserve to die, but in Fernando Castillo, he even told the cop that he had a gun where he didn't have to. If the cop was nervous, he could have told him how to get his license, or I'll grab your license, or whatever. And you can hear the cop scream to her like he was scared, but he was trying to say, I did the right thing. In a weird way, that's what I got from him. And in the Alton Sterling case, it was just like the cops didn't seem to give a fuck. It's just like, you know what? I'm just going to kill you if you don't fucking stay still. And as far as I'm concerned, I mean, that was a case of the cops could have came up to him. They could have explained what happened. He could have said, I didn't pull a gun on anybody. Who's the person that called? They could have straightened all that out. Now, again, he had a gun concealed and he would have got charged with that and a bunch of other things. But he wouldn't be dead. But if you try to stand up for your rights, because you think about it, if you have cops come up to you and tell you to get on the ground and you didn't do anything. So think about that for a minute. No one ever thinks about from the side of these people that are being murdered. There are a lot of people just have the attitude, well, if the cops killed them, then they must have deserved it. But looking at it from his perspective, and of course, Fernando Castillo, I mean, what else could he have done? He told a cop he had a gun. And he told him he had a permit. There's no other way he could have handled that situation. As far as trying to help the cop. Because he could have just said nothing. But again, I don't know if the cop would have seen the gun when he got his license. But anyway, so he was trying to actually give information that you don't have to give. You don't have to. There's some states, I believe, that have a law that if you're armed, you have to tell the cop, which really is another unconstitutional law, but it doesn't matter. the thing about the Constitution, which is just a piece of paper that people think it's magical, like somehow it stops unconstitutional stuff from happening, is that there's no check before a law is passed. For a law to be deemed unconstitutional, something has to happen where that law is violated and you have standing, and then you have to take it to court and it has to go all the way to the Supreme Court. It's not like before they pass a law, they have some kind of test. They don't even think about that shit. There's been cases where they didn't want it to go to the next court, so they dismissed it. I actually know somebody personally that it happened to, and at least that's what they think, because that it would open up a whole can of worms there, so they didn't have to overturn the law. So in his case, what could he have done differently? Nothing. He was actually trying to be honest with the cops. I wouldn't have told him anything, because you don't have to. Although he was in Minnesota, so maybe there the law says you do. I don't know. And with Alton Sterling, he's standing there selling CDs. Cops come up to him and tell him, get on the ground. And I don't know if they had their guns drawn. I think they did. And that's even worse. And that's what I had in my situation. You know, I had a gun pretty much to my head. And it's like, okay, what did I do? If they just come right up to you, now if there's already, especially when you didn't do anything. Now, if you knew you did something, you probably still play the, well, what the fuck did I do? But why would you just get on the ground when you didn't do anything without asking, well, what did I do? And of course, again, the cops just get on the ground. So then they, from what I understand, they did what they could to get them on the ground, including tasering him. And I doubt anything will happen in that case neither. The cops will say, well, he had a gun. He was reaching for it. I shot him. And the, I guess, travesty to all this is that Black Lives Matter, which I believe was hijacked by the progressive operatives or whatever anyway. And I don't think the majority, I've said this, that the majority of people that are even marching in these marches with Black Lives Matter necessarily agree with their philosophy anyway. They may be marching because they're just marching against police killing people. But they are just making things worse because they're changing the conversation. And I said this whole thing, even with the Michael Brown case in the beginning, that it's like a whole planned out fucking thing in a way, because there were so many people getting murdered by police. That was the case, the first case that they decided to cover nationally. And that was a case that was not clear cut. There was cases on, I have cases from years ago. I mentioned yesterday that I had his sister on the show. I can't think of his name right now. Where you have video of, and they're Mexican, of her brother being straight up murdered by a cop. And this is, what, 2009, 2010? And on video and everything, got suspended for 4 days. So video doesn't even mean shit anyway. Like this whole thing with put body cams on them, it doesn't matter. But my point being that there's all these people that are killed by police. That's the one they cover. You have so many that you had the guy on video who he didn't get killed, but he got pulled over at a gas station. I believe it was either North or South Carolina. Gets pulled over at a gas station. He's standing outside his car. Cop says, license and registration. He turns around to get his license, and the cop starts shooting at him. Luckily, he didn't die. This was not national news. This was, of course, on the internet, on Free Thought Project, sites like that. You know, I talked about it, of course, on my show. Independent media on the internet. I'm sure in North Carolina or South Carolina, wherever it happened, it was on their local media, but they didn't make that a national story and make a big deal about it. And they had it on video. Why not? Well, because it's obvious that the cop was wrong and the cop was totally fucked up. But in the Michael Brown case, you had different people saying different things. It started it wasn't clear what happened. You didn't have video. You had one side saying one thing, the other saying something else. So you got to divide people, get people to argue. You got to create this whole thing. And that's a type of case that they wanted to promote on media because they wanted to make it about race at the same time, divide people. And that's what they did with it. So if you look at, I mean, there were a couple of cases that they just couldn't ignore. And I think these are two cases that because they went viral, it gets to a point where the media can't ignore them. And when there's protest all over the country, they have to cover them. But they figured out a way in how they cover them now and how to spin them. And spin them so it goes along with the government's agenda of making this about totally about race. Not to say that it has nothing to do with race, but making it totally about race and not talking anything about the police, them being out of control, them having too many rights, them having a monopoly on force, all of these things that they could change because they're not changing them because they don't give a fuck. They want to take more control, not less. That's why they gave them all these weapons because they're planning for civil unrest. They're planning to fucking take over. And if you're not going to go along with what the government wants you to go along with, well, they got a heavily armed police to help, and they want a heavily armed federal police, which is essentially an occupying army. The story I mentioned earlier, and I hate that I even have to do this because to me, this is not about race. This is about the police and them being fucked up. But now I have to look at cases and find, okay, let me find all the white people that were killed. Let me find the Hispanic people that are killed. And to me, it's about, like I said earlier, I don't look at this as, I don't identify with race. I'm a person. And I don't feel like these are my people or these are my people. As I said earlier, my people are the people that believe in true freedom and liberty and want people to be able to live their own lives how they want, as long as they don't hurt anybody. But this case of a 19-year-old whose mother was there, an unarmed teenager, was killed by Fresno police. And the police files claim it says there was no reasonable basis to shoot. And this is a white kid. And of course, nothing will happen the same as the other cases. But you don't hear about this one because it doesn't fit into their narrative. And it's not about, well, you don't hear about it just because he's white. Yes, that's why you don't hear about it. But him being white doesn't fit into the narrative of what they're trying to do. And that is make it about race to stop people from getting to the root of the problem, which is the police themselves and how the police are out of control, and that the police, like I said, in my opinion, shouldn't exist. You know, I have a Facebook page and the government police, because there shouldn't be government police. There should be separate security companies, and you should have a choice of who protects you. Or if you even want to pay for somebody to protect you. And for the people that can't afford it, you know, that's where people will either help, because obviously they want their neighborhood to be safe. So they'll help other people in their neighborhood that can't afford it. Or people would rather go with a company that is helping people that can't afford it. So either way, it's a benefit to the company, where it's a charity thing. And that's what they do with the Detroit, in Detroit, with the Detroit Threat Management Center. And I can't get this article to come up, but I have it posted on and the government police on Facebook. And I have the other article posted that I mentioned about Henry David Howell, who I think he was in his 60s. The police went to the wrong house, and they saw shadows outside. So he went outside with his gun, you know, like somebody probably would, to protect their family. And police shot him and killed him. And he was white as well. There was another guy who I mentioned earlier, also 29, killed in prison. I think it was made to look like a suicide, but it was ruled a homicide. Looks like the prison guards killed him. And a lot of places, certain prisons have the police there as prison guards, like here in Vegas, at least at the Clark County Detention Center. So I don't know if it was, you know, whether it's prison guards or police, it's kind of the same thing. But whether they were specifically police, quote unquote, or not, I don't know. We only have a couple minutes left. As far as I mentioned the conspiracy, which I don't think it is. The one thing, though, they using the bomb robot is very disturbing. And from what I heard, the body was so badly burnt they couldn't even get fingerprints off him. So, you know, conspiracy theorists could say, was it really him? You know, they kept going back and forth saying, for a while they were saying there were two suspects. They had or three suspects. They had two in custody. So they kept changing the story there. But again, I don't know, or I haven't heard anything that makes me think that it wasn't him that did it. As far as some of the things the police said, who knows? You can't really believe what you hear from the police. If the only source of information is the police, and I mentioned this yesterday, I had police reports written about me that were totally untrue. If your only source of information is the police, you can't just take the police and the media's word for something, especially government media. You need to find different sources and multiple sources and think about, does this make sense? Not just read something saying, well, this makes no sense, or this sounds impossible, like the shooting in Orlando, that one person did that, to me sounds impossible. So I definitely have doubts that one person did that. It could have been, I mentioned the SWAT teams could have came in and killed a bunch of people, maybe on purpose, to get up the death count so they could use that. Now, it could have been by accident too. Who knows? But the media is just a tool of the government, at least what's on all these news channels and, you know, networks and things like that. Luckily, we have the internet. That's why there were so many bills where they've been going after the internet. And they probably will continue to go after the internet, because that affects them. That is what is getting out all this information and opening people's eyes and making them aware of the government. But that's all the time we have for tonight. I'd like to thank everybody for joining us. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Again, if you'd like to donate, there is a donate screen there. I don't think that you can donate change. I think it's only even. I tried to set it up where you can donate change, but when I tried, I couldn't. So, but if you'd like to donate, hey, that's great. If not, no problem. I'm just happy that I have listeners at all. So, thanks everybody for listening, and I will see you tomorrow. Have a good night.
With the orders of police officers, resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.